Christmas is getting ever closer. Decorations are still up all around me here. I went all out. You can tell. One string of garland, sparkly stuff, and a couple of Santa hats. Christmas is getting closer. You know, that is a minor theme of this program. Ham Radio Now, 286, Contact Sport. Taking the easy way out, just stealing the name of the book that I'm going to talk about some. Get the light reflection off of it, and making it the name of the show. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And I went to Dayton, soon to be known as the world-famous Green County Ham Fest. Don't worry, they're still going to call it Dayton. So I did go, and I recorded a bunch of forums, and you've already seen those. And I recorded a bunch of interviews, and you haven't seen those. Other stuff seems to have gotten in the way. And after I've recorded stuff, and then time passes, I tend to not go back and pick things up. I really should. There's some good interviews in there. And one of them is the guy that wrote this book, J.K. George, N3BB, I think it's his call sign. But I'm bringing this up now because if you are still looking for a present for this holiday season, Christmas present or whatever, for a ham, this would be a good one. So I was wandering around the Ham Fest looking for people to interview, and I came upon this booth, and it had this book, Contact Sport, and the other book, The Reunion. And I'm going, what the heck is that? Had no idea. But what the heck, I'll take the camera over there and talk to the guy. And then I found out what it was all about. I tell you what, before I say any more about it, because I have read it now, but at that point I hadn't, and I didn't know anything about it. Let's take a look at the interview. We'll get to that in just a second. I need to point out Arvin back there, as usual. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the programs and you have not contributed ever or not in a long time or whatever, still feel generous, stop by hamradionow.tv, the website, go to the bottom of the page, any of the pages, you'll see Arvin's icon. No, I guess you got to go to the first page, the home page. It's the only place he appears, that and the contribution page. Go to the bottom of the home page, click on his icon, take you to the contribution page where your options are Patreon, credit card, PayPal, sending me money. Good deal. Let's sneak on over to Dayton for the last time at the Hera Arena, which is, I think, getting torn down, and talk to this guy, J.K. George.
So the humor part is that, hold that good and close because it's real noisy in here. You are in between... just barely see it there, the old timers club,
and
over here is the youth booth, and you are Contact Sport.
I
saw some irony in that. Have you had to keep these people apart?
They're at each other's throats. In fact, if it were not for myself, we would have a war going on in here. But no, it's actually been pretty peaceful.
Okay,
thanks for asking.
What is Contact Sport?
Contact Sport is a clever title of a book thought up by K1DG, Doug Grant. But I'm the author, and it's a book in general about ham radio. It's really about people, but specifically it's about the competition event, the World RadioSport Team Championship.
WRTC, everybody's
WRTC in Boston and New England in the summer of 2014, and specifically in July.
There's been a really good documentary video made of that.
Yeah, actually, the video is made by James Brooks, 9V1YC.
Yeah, the second best video producer in ham radio.
Of course. I wonder who is number one. Let's see, who could
go?
Gary Pierce, I think. But anyhow, yeah, James had a crew up there filming it, and I talked with him. He and I are friends because when he was a student at the University of Texas in Double E, he operated from my house in Austin. We did a lot of contesting together, and I've kept up with James, visited him at his home numerous times in Singapore. But he was doing the video, and I'm writing the book. I've got the book.
And what's the book all about? Well, it's all about WRTC.
Well,
what kind of stuff do you get into?
It's about people. I mean, there are 59 teams from 40 countries. They're the same. There are 59 referees from another group of countries, and it's about people. It's about competition, and as with any competition, there can only be one winner. There's also a silver award winner and a bronze, but a lot of people were disappointed. You know, out of 59 teams, you have a number one and you have a number 59. And some people had problems. They overcame them with different degrees of success or had that different amounts of problems. But weather was good. Conditions were good. Spectacular number of contacts. Some of the teams made, let me think, I think it was almost 5,000 contacts in 24 hours.
Yep. WRTC is, for those that are not super familiar with it, a contest within a contest.
It is. It's beginning to be known as the Olympics of amateur radio.
You can't say that.
You can't.
I can say that. You can't say that.
Okay, all right.
Well, you're not involved with the WRTC yourself, right?
I am not.
Okay, so you can say it.
I can say it.
We can say it. They can't say it.
It occurs.
You know why?
Why?
Because the Olympics is very protective of their name. They'll sue the heck out of you.
Oh, well, why
don't send the lawyers guns and money.
Let's don't do that, then.
Yeah. But you and I, we can say that because we're journalists.
Okay, we're journalists. But the WRT is embedded every 4 years in an ongoing contest, the IARU, which fundamentally allows these 50 or 60 teams to sit there and compete in a spectrum in a world made up of around 10,000 amateur radio operators on the air.
So it's a huge contest.
Huge contest.
Fills the bands. Do these guys stand out?
They do because they're given unique call signs. In fact, on the ones up in New England, they had three-letter call signs. For example, W1A or Kilo 1 Tango, and that identifies them as participants and competition teams.
Do people on the air care about that?
They do.
Generally running the big contest, do they say, oh, that's a WRTC, I'm going to work that guy?
As a matter of fact, not only do they care, some of the people spend their entire 24 hours basically only searching out for these 59 teams and getting them at least on one frequency band, but it's considered quite a prize to work all 59 in the same weekend.
The book has the good, the bad, and the ugly?
The book has the good, the bad, and the ugly. It certainly has some trials and tribulations that people overcome. It also has some ugly. It turns out the fellow that wrote the book, he will go unidentified, but some people say he's related to N3BB. He ends up being a volunteer driver, and he shows up in the backwoods of New England with this unsuspecting German team, DL1IAO and DJ5MW, and he manages to get them thoroughly lost in the backwoods of New England. And these poor fellows are worried about getting
frantic
on the air.
Because they're limited time, right?
They're frantic, but all in all, they get back to the hotel in time. All in all, the German team solves a problem. They find a soldering iron. They develop a miraculous solution to a problem they have. And they do get on the air. And not only do they get on the air, but after a fast and furious and dramatic finish, they win the bronze medal in a razor thin finish that I must say...
Try to gin up a little more enthusiasm.
I must say, stresses some long-time friendships to the max.
Within the team?
This team and other teams.
Ah. Right, because it's razor-thin.
It's a razor-thin competitive finish.
Yeah.
But it was a wonderful opportunity. I added a lot of things. In fact, my ideal reader would be a 13-year-old boy or girl in junior high or high school that's never heard the word amateur radio, ham radio. And I'm hoping this would not only maybe expose the hobby to some people as a lot of fun, but also expose science, engineering, technology as a field of study to more and more young people.
So it's written from a more general audience perspective.
Very, very. It's not going to bore a really high-level ham radio competitor. I think they'll find it fascinating. It's there.
But a sentence doesn't start as, we fired up on sideband on 75 meters, and the band was alive.
It doesn't say that we spent the entire weekend on, 3504 with 45 word a minute CW or whatever.
But does it get into that enough, the flavor's there?
It does. I think,
because that's a delicate balance. You
over a 24-hour contest, also, I track the... I track the progress of the teams. One team, as a matter of fact, who were the team from Lithuania, they suffered a complete computer failure and were down for 4 hours with only one station running and not two. They fell all the way to number 57 or 58 out of 59 and battled their way back. At the end of the thing, they were number six and almost number five. I mean, this is a team that went down and came back up. The American team that ended up in a really razor-thin finish, they ended up falling as low as, I think, 17 or 18 and ended up challenging for the win at the end of the thing. So it's a good human interest story.
These things didn't come out in the James Brooks documentary. So there's a lot in the book that, I mean, if you've watched the documentary, you might say, why do I need a book? I know everything that happened. Clearly, he didn't tell, because there's too many stories to tell.
Well, sure, you have to focus.
No, but, I'm not criticizing him. I'm just saying there's
more
in there to get.
I had the advantage of sitting there for a year writing this book and bringing in a number of things. And I must say, when people realized I was writing a book, I was flooded with quote-unquote inside information, okay? Shall we call it inside information?
Yeah, let me tell you something off the record.
Off the record.
Yeah, I hate off the record. Don't tell me anything off the record. I'm going to blab.
It was a lot of fun.
So do you? Are you normally an author, or is this a sidelight for you?
Well, I worked for 38 years mainly for Motorola in the semiconductor chip industry.
So, yeah, you write software.
But I did not. I actually was a transistor developer. The actual, I wasn't a circuit guy, but I was the guy that made and designed the small, literally little NPN and PNP transistors and field effect transistors. And my first book, can you pan over there to Reunion? Reunion was my first book.
Right behind you.
Reunion was my first book. It's a novel written about growing up in southern West Virginia in the 60s. It has a lot of things in it, but it's fundamentally about relationships and a father-son relationship and peer group relationships. And it's about the class coming together for a reunion, their 45th reunion, and things either get resolved or don't get resolved that had festered for a long time. But when this book came out, Doug Grant, K1DG, was one of the readers. I didn't know that at the time. He read it in New Hampshire and contacted me to write Contact Sport. He said, Jim, I need your help. I've got a great opportunity, but I have a fellow lined up to write Contact Sport. His name is Mark Obmasik. He's a journalist that lives in Denver, Colorado. He's the guy that wrote the very best-selling book, The Big Year, about competitive bird watching. And he said, unfortunately, he just got pulled off of writing my book, this is Doug Grant, to write a book about the legalization of marijuana in Colorado. He said, I'm high and dry, and I read your book, Reunion. I know you can write. I know you understand ham radio. Can you come up and write it? And I said, wow, you're giving me a whole 2 months to do this, to get ready? I said,
How long a book is it?
The book is 330 pages.
In 2 months?
That was to go cover it.
Oh, to go cover it. Okay, yeah.
I found a publisher. They backed it. They thought it was, quote, unique, quirky, and interesting, unquote. And so here we are. I went up and spent a week with New England. Doug got me into the hotel, gave me an all-access pass. I embedded myself with a German team as a driver. They would probably tell you a pretty goofy driver that got lost. But it was a lot of fun. And then I spent 9 months writing it. I've spent the last year or so marketing it, PRing it, and promoting it.
Is this published as a... Okay, so it's a physical book, not just an online book.
No, it's available right now in hardcover and online. And all the ebook formats are available.
Kindle and...
Everything. Kindle, Nook, Google Books, iTunes, every sort of... download that anybody can think of.
And when did it actually go on the market?
It was released nationally and internationally on February the 1st of this year, 2014.
Okay, so it's
currently available worldwide and many bookstores and certainly all the online retailers.
It's selling like hotcakes.
It's selling like reasonably warm cakes. Hotcakes, yeah, hotcakes. It's selling, well, this is a I'll be honest with your audience. Okay, folks, this is the real truth. It's selling like hotcakes in the ham radio community, especially with contesters. I, however, wanted it to break out of the amateur radio market. I wanted it to break into the general audience market, like the Big Year did.
I'm thinking a ham who has got kids who have not caught the ham radio bug. They just wonder what daddy, and maybe mama does in the basement with all that strange stuff, and then they're back to watching YouTube. This would be an interesting thing to try to foist on the kids, push it down to that next generation.
This would be a tremendous gift, by the way, to nephew, to grandson, to niece, and it's a matter of fact, it's going to be listed in many of the gift guides during the summer and during the fall. I went pretty far with this thing. I hired a public relations firm in New Jersey, a well-known national firm, not inexpensive. I've done marketing. The book has been reviewed on Scientific American, by QST, by CQ, by a number of online bloggers and reviewers. It's gotten really, really good press, and I can honestly look your audience in the eye and saying it's very well written, it's edited, it's error-free, it has 60 photographs in it, it has all the review, all the records of all previous WRTCs, has a nice index, has a map. It's a first-class work.
It's a real book.
It's a real book.
Yeah, because in ham radio media has, you know, we're not always really real.
This one's real. And by the way, I think I realistically qualify as a content expert. It's my second book, and also I competed in one of the previous WRTCs in Slovenia, and then I was a referee in a previous WRTC in Helsinki, Finland. So I know what it's like to be there as a competitor, to struggle through it with all the pressure, the ups and the downs. I know what it's like to be a referee and see teams struggle and do well and come and go, and now I can write about it.
You know what you're talking about. And to be a competitor in a WRTC, you had to have been a high-ranking contester for the previous couple of years in all the big contests.
Many, many years of serious contesting, yes. Okay. My favorite contest is the sprint. I love that. I have to get in a sprint, a small commercial. But no, I've done them all.
Yep. Is there any ham radio in Reunion?
Yes. As a matter of fact, there's a lot of stuff in Reunion. There's rock and roll of the 60s, there's AM broadcasting experience, there's a kid that gets his novice license in the middle of nowhere in West Virginia and gets on and has a great time. We talk about mentors and we talk about kids coming of age and, questioning values in life and questioning what it's all about and dealing with family and friends and peer group relationships and having girlfriends and losing girlfriends and doing silly things racing and
ham radio is supposed to be all there is in life. We're supposed to be monofocused.
Well, there is amateur radio in the book. I think it's just the right amount. But again, the Reunion was written for the general audience as well.
Yeah. Are you trying to say that a ham is balanced?
A ham is supposed to be balanced. I'm saying he's supposed to be balanced.
Yeah.
I've been doing this for 58 years.
They all look fair and balanced to me.
All right.
So, awesome. I haven't seen you on the rest of the ham radio media circuit, the Ham Nation, whatever else. Have you been on any of those other shows?
I was interviewed by Eric Guth, who's an Israeli podcaster.
Yeah, Eric does high-class stuff.
I thought it was wonderful. He was extremely well-prepared. It's
unlike now, where it's I didn't know you from
Adam
at the moment.
He's almost as well-prepared as you are, Gary. But no, that was a first-class thing. And
he's the second-best podcaster in ham radio.
No, he did a good job. I had quite a bit of favorable feedback, and people emailed and said, hey, I heard your interview. I bought the book, and I'd go, wonderful, wonderful.
But there's a lot more ham media out there now that you can tap. I don't know if you've dug into any of these other shows.
I am pursuing a couple right now as we speak.
Okay, but as we speak, turn to the camera. I've got this camera pointed right at you. Talk to all those. You can look at this one. This is your close up. You're ready for your close up, Mr. DeMille. tell people you're available for interviews.
I am. I'm available. I've been on 6 radio stations so far. Been on Eric's podcast. I'm on hold. That's a generous description. I'm on hold with Michelle Martin on NPR's Weekend Edition. I'm on hold with 2 producers at WBUR in Boston for a program throughout New England. I'm on hold with Georgia Public Broadcasting along with K4BAI, John Laney, with a 17-station broadcast in Georgia. And I'm on hold with Kentucky News Network, which is an iHeart broadcasting network through the state of Kentucky with 24 stations, I think.
On hold means you're never going to call,
on hold,
right?
Means I haven't been scheduled yet. So if you're out there, Michelle Martin, WBUR, and Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Yeah, she's a big fan of Ham Radio Now, I can
yeah,
tell you.
Yeah, there you
that.
Go. There you go.
So, well, hopefully you'll get at least some of that.
I'm hoping.
Because that's all general media, and we need all the professional general media we can get.
And I'm available for any additional famous ham radio media people.
Yeah. Because
so, additional, you notice,
again,
like
you
yourself.
You want this in ham radio, but also in the general media.
Yes, no, seriously, absolutely.
That's really cool.
I think it's a good story. I think it's a story about magic. It's a story about radio told from almost a Harry Potter point of view. In fact, I chose to treat one band opening, which was a really weird key, short-term, 10-meter opening from New England to Europe. It opened, believe it or not, at 6 o'clock Sunday morning. Now, the contest ends at 8 o'clock Sunday morning. And at 6:30 in the morning, 10 meters had a spotty opening to Europe. And if you were there, even with 100 watts and a small antenna, Yagi, you could work 20 or 25 multipliers. This was really important. That could make you go from number 25 to number 15, or conversely, from number 15 to 25. And some people went up and some people went down. And so I treated that band opening as quote-unquote hidden treasure. And I likened hidden treasure to a video game where you're out there competing, you've got monsters, you've got things, you're dodging swords and you're doing things, and voila, here's a band opening with hidden treasure. And so that's one example of treating the subject matter in a fantastical manner.
That sounds wonderful. I am pretty sure I'm going to be reading that real soon.
Okay, good.
Okay, so in the meantime, over there, there's a lady over there looking pretty vicious at the old-timers club.
To the youth club?
I think she's got a knitting needle. Yeah, I think she's plotting over here. Well,
the youth booth looks like it could use a few more participants.
Well, I think what's happened is they've got their forum going on right now.
Okay, that's good.
So that's
all
why
right.
they're not okay. there. But as soon as they come charging back, you know, they're all going to be all hepped up on ham radio.
They'll have to keep them apart from the knitting lady. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So you got your work cut out for you.
All right.
Jim, it's been a pleasure talking to you. I'm just a little hidden
treasure.
Hidden treasure for me to come across here. I looked at it as a reunion. What the heck is this guy doing in a ham radio thing? Well, at least he's got a call sign. Let's find out.
Where does KN4AQ live?
Raleigh, North Carolina.
Raleigh, North Carolina. Very good. Yep. Very good. Well, I used to be KN8JPV in southern West Virginia. So
I like the KN. It's because it's, you know, it's a novice advanced call.
There you go. There you
and,
go.
And when I got it, 89, I've been a ham since 65, but I got that call.
I was 60. I was actually 58. So
you beat me a little bit.
Beat you a little bit.
Yep. So I got that when I moved to Tennessee, and I thought, oh, cool, it's a novice call. The Foreland is now just beginning to come KN4 by 3 for the technician.
Oh, really?
And
they're up to
else.
The KN so, prefix, huh?
Yeah, we're the biggest. Back when we got started, Foreland was dead. There was
it was more than AIDS. But
it was a huge geographic area because nobody lived there, and hams were not generating.
But now everybody's going there. Huh?
Yeah, now we're huge, and they need to give probably North Carolina and what's the farthest western state? Mississippi's five land.
Well, Memphis, Tennessee.
Maybe send Kentucky and Tennessee out.
Yeah, Paducah, Kentucky, that's about
Kentucky
as far.
Kentucky needs to go up into eight land, and Tennessee can go over into five land. And
let's make the forest more rare, huh?
Yeah, yeah. And because we're running out of call signs. I don't know what they're going to do.
All right.
It's been a pleasure, Jim. Thanks.
Thank you, Gary. I very much appreciate it. 73, everybody.
And buy the book.
Buy the book.
Yeah, I had never heard of it, and now I have. So I did read the book. I'm not sure I can do a serious review of the book. I'm not really good at those. Boy, did I hate doing book reports when I was back in school. I think I probably failed to do most of them. What I'm looking for here is that I bought the book at the booth, and I asked him to do to autograph it, or he offered to autograph it. And so I suggested, and you heard the little banter about the James Brooks documentary. Oh, this one here, the WRTC 2014, the video documentary. If you haven't watched the video documentary, you really should. Let me see if I can play a little bit of that. It's going to take a while to get through the promotional stuff. Fortunately, I can just zoom in.
Never done this before?
We thought we had a disaster on our hands.
I'm not sure that somebody can do this every 4 years.
Yeah, so if you haven't watched the documentary, you really should.
Before the start of the contest, so they have enough time to program the voice keyers and the Morse keyers. So about a minute away from doing so.
I mean, even if you're not a contester, it's still pretty interesting to see. So as I mentioned in the interview, even if you've watched the documentary, there's still lots of stuff in the book that goes into much greater detail. I was guessing that would be the case when I did the interview. Now that I've read the book, I can tell you it for certain is. So I asked him, or he offered to autograph it for me. And so playing off of the little banter we did about James Brooks in his video, I said, "What? Make it out to the Ham Radio's number one producer of video in the world." And since he's a good friend of James Brooks, he couldn't quite say that. So he said to Gary KN4AQ, known to some as the number one ham radio producer in the world, known to some. That some would include me and a few of you. So 73 Jim N3BB, Dayton, May 2016. And then the other guy that you saw wandering around in the booth and dealing with people to keep Jim able to be occupied with the interview is Bob, N6TV. And he did the photography in the book. Fast can I find some? Yeah, there's some. Oh, it's all black and white. There's no color, but good pictures. It helps flesh things out. So let me talk about what I found out in reading the book, and recommend to you that it would be a good present for a ham. And while I'm talking about that, let's take a quick look. This is Jim's website. AuthorJKGeorge.com, for those of you just listening and unable to see this. And it's got some history, his biography, things like that. And I have bought a few to be presents to people, and I got them over here on Amazon. It's currently selling on Amazon for $18.24. I actually paid more at the booth, a little bit more. So what about it? As I said, compared to the video, it has a lot more depth. Jim, as he mentioned in the interview, was a contestant in years past. He was a referee in years past, so he knew the subject matter intimately. And the good thing about the book, the really good thing about the book, is that you really get detail about how this contest worked. And again, he tried not to make it strictly to appeal to ham radio operators. So it gets general enough and it explains things enough that someone who's not a ham can still get a lot of value out of it. But if you are a ham, you're still going to learn a lot of things that happen in a big contest like this, or a very specialized activity like the World Radio Sport Team Championship. And so I found it interesting all the way through. About the only thing that I would criticize is that it tends to be a little bit redundant. He'll sort of explain, or the same activities seem to happen repetitively, not thousands of times or even dozens of times, but several times throughout the book. He'll describe sort of the same thing that is happening, because a contest like that is fairly repetitive. Hour after hour goes by about the same. So that's the impression that I got. But what I really appreciated was, first of all, getting to know the people. A lot of literature in ham radio. I haven't read a lot of literature in ham radio. the few that I have, a lot of names, a lot of dates, and not much feel for what really goes on. He does a good job of describing how things are really happening, the way they made the contacts, how they transmitted, how, what they said, what they heard, how they got things logged, how they handled problems, and lots of problems cropped up. Not just Jim getting lost trying to get his crew back to the headquarters hotel, but lots of things, little things and big things went wrong. And he doesn't get into the difficulty, the bad feelings that people had as much as he might have. He soft pedals it maybe a little bit. And what I'm talking about here is that some of the teams that didn't do very well felt that their locations were suboptimal. They weren't, in theory, their signals should be just as good as everybody else. And everything should then depend on operator skill. All of the locations should give people good signals. But some of them felt that they had a somewhat suboptimal horizon to looking toward Europe, main source of contacts. And they thought that was some of the reason why they weren't making contacts as well as they should. I don't know if that would be true. You know, there's no way really to know whether that was going to be true or not, because they all were good competitive contest operators. So you can't really say, well, I'm sorry, you weren't a very good contester. That's why you didn't make the contacts. They all knew how. Interesting, though, about that 10-meter thing, that some of them caught it and some of them didn't, and the ones that did tended to get helped out quite a bit in their position in the event. The thing that I absolutely can't determine from reading the book is whether it is going to accomplish one of his primary goals, which is to make a book of general interest to anybody, not necessarily to hams, and not necessarily with the goal of creating a ham, getting somebody interested in the subject matter of the book, and then saying, wow, I really want to get into that ham radio. This looks like a great thing to do. I can't tell how interested someone would be if they're not a ham, because I've been a ham for too long, and I haven't tried it out on a focus group and said, here, read this book and see if you like it. So certainly that's going to be, some people will say, yeah, I thought that was a pretty good book, and some people will say, no, didn't really appeal to me. So I will certainly recommend it for hams. If you know a ham who hasn't gotten this, hasn't read it, and they enjoy literature, get them this book. If you hurry, you'll get it in time for Christmas. I would say if you've got a young person who has been around ham radio, been exposed to it, and you want them to get a more in-depth look, well, show them the video. You know, let them get a look at that and read the book for a little bit more depth. And I think that they'll probably enjoy it. A little bit hard to tell. I'm not sure that would be the case, but I'd say it's worth a shot. And if it's for someone who is totally not interested in ham radio, but maybe they're interested in technology, then, or contests, things like that, then they can go for it. So that's my take. I wish I could be a little more definitive on how well it would work, but I, you know, can't tell. Don't think you could either. So that will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Oh, one other thing I was thinking of. One other thing I wanted to bring up. In terms of the radio, WRTC, I've got a website they want. I've got a website URL that I think that they would want, because WRTC doesn't mean anything. World Radio Sport Team Championship is a mouthful. So I've got the URL that they want, and it's theirs for the asking, but they have to ask me. It is the Radio Games. Jeff and I talked about that in a previous episode, and I thought, okay, well, I'll go over to Hover and register it. So I've got that, and I will give it away. I'll reassign it to whoever is in a legitimate position to handle something like that. If they want it, they can ask for it. The Radio Games. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. Once again, Arvin still sitting back there, Chief Financial Officer. Stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, if you enjoy the programs and help us out. But first, before you do that, go get this book. It's worthwhile. I am Gary Pierce, 73. Over and out.